second speaker for the second session is Dr. Anupam Saraph. He's a trustee of Moneylife Foundation and has held CXO and ministerial level positions and has served as an independent director on the board of public private sector companies and NGOs. As a professor of system governance and decision sciences, environmental systems and businesses, he teaches and mentors students at universities in Europe, Asia and the Americas. He is actively engaged in environmental resource and natural conservative initiatives. He has authored draft legislations for river and natural resource conservation, right to good governance, and has also contributed to the election and democratic reforms. He also advises the World Economic Forum through its Global Agenda Council for Complex Systems and the Club of Rome Indian National Association as a founder life member. Dr. Saraph holds a PhD in designing sustainable systems for the Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences of the University of Groningen, the Netherlands. He has a MSc in Molecular Biology and BSc in Zoology. We are honored to have you here, sir. I now request Principal Ma'am to felicitate, sir.
The second session will throw light on Section 4 of the RTI Act and how it would help in better governance. I request Dr. Anupam Saraph, sir, to take over. Thank you.
Very good morning. Okay, so I think you have had an excellent overview on RTI and almost all the sections. What I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in into Section 4, as was mentioned by Shailesh Gandhi. Section 4 is one of the parts of the Right to Information Act. The key word here is right to information, right? So what is a right? When you exercise any right, do you need to seek any permission from somebody? When you exercise your right, it is something that you just exercise. There is no need to seek a permission. So the real part of this entire act, which confers the right, is Section 4. Because in Section 4, you really don't need to go and ask for information. You don't need permission from a public information officer that can you please give me this information. This is information which should be available to you. So Section 4 of the Right to Information Act is actually that which truly would confer the right to you if it is exercised. So I'm going to start off by actually telling you something about one case where I exercised this Section 4, and then we'll go and talk about Section 4. So all of you must have been following with some interest the Aadhaar judgments. Have you all been following this Aadhaar judgments? How many of you? Put up your hands. Okay, couple of you. So how many petitions were heard together? 1, 2, 3, 5, 10. How many petitions were heard together as a part of the Aadhaar judgments which were issued last month, two months ago in October? How many petitions were heard together? Was it one petition or many petitions? No idea? 38 petitions were clubbed together, and 38 petitions were heard together as a part of the Aadhaar judgment. So if you look at each petition, how many prayers do you expect would have been part of each petition? 4 or 5 prayers? Right? So on an average, how many prayers should have been responded to or answered by the Supreme Court by dealing with these judgments that came out? Roughly about 120 or 150, right? So how many of you have actually seen these judgments? There were 3 judgments, right? There were three judgments which came out of the Aadhaar petitions which were heard together. If you read these judgments, do they somewhere state which prayers have been responded to and which prayers have not been responded to? How many of you have seen the judgments? None? None of you have seen the judgments? Okay. So I would urge you that please go back and look at these judgments, three judgments. There was a so-called majority judgment which was written by Justice Sikri on behalf of the chief and on behalf of Justice Khanvilkar. Then there was a judgment by Justice Bhushan, and there was another judgment by Justice Chandrachud. And Justice Chandrachud declared the Aadhaar Act as a constitutional fraud, as a fraud on the Constitution of India. The other two judgments kind of did not agree with that view. I can't understand how it can be both fraud and not fraud at the same time. But that's a separate matter. If you go back to these judgments, none of these judgments actually list out the prayers which have been addressed and which have not been addressed. So there are paragraphs in the judgments which say which are the issues which were before them that they have considered, but they do not list out the prayers which have been answered. Now, since it is a matter of 38 different petitions which have been heard, is it fair to expect that the Supreme Court will say which of these prayers they have taken a decision on? Or is it unfair? If you are the Shahenshah or the Begum of this country, are you well within your rights to actually expect to be told that, you know, 150 prayers we listen to and we have actually decided on, you know, 100 of these, and here are our decisions? Is it fair or is it unfair? It's fair, isn't it? Because in fact even none of the individual petitioners were told that your prayer has been heard or not heard. So if justice has to be delivered, it's a fair expectation that I know. And since I had drafted at least one of those 38 petitions, and I know that none of my prayers have been addressed, is it fair for, and even if I were not a petitioner, is it fair for me to ask? So I decided to ask the Supreme Court under Section 4C and 4D of the Right to Information Act. Okay? So here is the simple letter which I sent under Section 4C and 4D to the Supreme Court of India, to the Public Information Officer of the Supreme Court of India, by email to the email address given on their website. So 41C simply says that they have to publish all relevant facts when formulating important policy decisions or announcing decisions which affect the public. Does the Aadhaar judgment affect the public? Yes. Would the prayers, their decisions on the prayers affect the public? Yes. So should I actually be informed about the important facts? Yes. 41D says that provide reasons for its administrative or quasi-judicial decisions to affected persons. Are we all affected persons because of Aadhaar? Should we have the reasons why they have arrived at a decision, or why they have said that we don't need to arrive at any decision and we have rejected all of your prayers? So, this is my question to the Public Information Officer. What do you expect? You know, so I had specifically said that I need four things. First, give me a copy of the prayers which were before the court. Is this something which should be there on the public website of the Supreme Court?
Yes.
It's unusual to ask. I don't think any court today actually puts up the prayers before it in public interest matters. I think there should be a debate about whether this should be made public or not. If these are questions before the court, for example, you may be aware that about 2 years back, the Supreme Court had a public interest litigation filed by a so-called NGO called Lokniti. And the orders in the Lokniti case were interpreted by the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India to cause coercion of linkage of Aadhaar to your SIMs across the country. And interestingly, the judgment delivered by the Supreme Court in the Aadhaar case indicated that that was a completely illegal exercise done by the TRAI. But nowhere on the Supreme Court website can we find what was the original petition or the prayers before it when it dealt with the Lokniti case. Should it have been available to us? Is it available to us today? No, no High Court or Supreme Court actually makes available any information about matters which pertain to the public. So if it is going to take decisions which pertain to the public, then these should be made available in some way or accessible to the public. So I said that please let me have a list of the prayers which were placed before you. The second is, what are the decisions taken by the court in each one of the prayers? And the third is, who are the parties who have been directed to act on the basis of these decisions? Because many times we find that the court actually rules something, but there is no responsibility placed on a particular individual or an authority to implement the order. So as a consequence, years down the road, you find that the orders, wonderful orders, have been passed, but there is no implementation. And if you file a contempt of court case, you will again be in litigation for years. So for example, there is a contempt of court case filed against the municipal corporation here for violating orders of the High Court of Mumbai about constructions carried out in water streams and rivers and laying sewers in rivers, filed in 2012. Still the contempt is being heard 6 years later. So if you have this scenario, then obviously it is important that we understand who is responsible and can this party be held responsible. So it's important that the orders state that. And then finally, I ask, is what is the recourse if any of the prayers have remained unanswered? Okay, so this is what I asked of the Supreme Court. Are these fair questions?
Yes.
So what would you expect to be the answer?
No answer.
Very good. So I expected that under section 41C and 41D, that because these are in some sense matters of liberty of citizens of India, that they should be answered fairly soon. And I requested that they should be answered within 72 hours as per the Act. And of course, I didn't expect that it would be answered in 72 hours. So I gave a full 10 days before I actually proceeded to do something else. So after not having heard from them for 10 days, I actually filed an appeal with the First Appellate Authority of the Supreme Court. Within 2 days, I got a response from the PIO after filing the appeal. Here is the response from the PIO. I'm sure you can't read it. But the long and short of it is this: the PIO says that, look, you can obtain certified copies of the judgment by using Rule 12 of the rules of the Supreme Court. So, in effect, what he is doing is he is misinterpreting what I have asked for. Firstly, he says that, look, you have not paid fees for asking for this information. And he is ignoring the fact that I have invoked Section 4. Section 6 requires me to pay fees. Section 4 means they are required to suo moto make information available to me. I am not required to pay any fees to obtain information which they should have made available in the first place. So they are in error. So he is now, the PIO is interpreting and saying that, look, this is a Section 6 application instead of treating it as a Section 4 application. Second is, he directs me to the Supreme Court rules saying that, look, you should obtain information using that, not under RTI. And then finally, he forgets the fact that the judgment, which is anyway available on the Supreme Court website, does not list information that I am asking for. Because that's not matter of the judgment, it's matter of records which are there with the Supreme Court bench, which actually heard the matter. So that information would have to be obtained from the bench. It cannot be obtained from the website, if at all he has to obtain it. And that's obviously something I cannot do. Interestingly, Shailesh Gandhi had ruled already on information which was asked from the Supreme Court by an earlier petitioner. And he had pointed out and he had disagreed with a previous Central Chief Information Commissioner, saying that information when asked under RTI has to be provided and you cannot cite any other law as necessary to obtain that information. It's the prerogative of one who seeks the information to invoke the right to information and seek information again against this RTI. So there is already a judgment of the CIC which says that this information should have been made available to me under RTI, and there is no need to invoke the Supreme Court rules and direct me to them in order to get this information. However, as we can see, that the PIO of the Supreme Court is clearly unaware of what the rulings have been in this matter and is clearly unaware of the Right to Information Act. So I think the challenge starts by ensuring that each PIO and in fact each public authority is aware of Section 4 of the Right to Information Act. If they are not aware of this act itself, then I think if they are not aware of Section 4, then definitely for Section 6, where the PIO can exercise a lot more power, you're going to be denied information. So let's start off with what is the purpose of the Right to Information Act. You know, right in the preamble of the act itself, it's very clear that it is for citizens to access information. So if it is for citizens to access information, the idea is that there has to be an access to information. And especially when you are trying to reach out to somebody who is physically far away from you, if you are trying to reach out to some information which may not be easily accessible to you, that is where creating that access is important. And it's also in order to promote transparency and accountability. So if you are to create transparency and accountability, obviously Section 4 becomes extremely important. If the PIO doesn't understand what is the purpose of the Right to Information Act, and if the PIO regards himself or herself as a gatekeeper to information, then essentially information will be denied. And I think fundamentally the problem of invoking Right to Information has become that the PIO regards himself or herself as a gatekeeper, not as somebody who is trying to enable transparency and accountability. Similarly, the first appellate authority regards himself or herself as a gatekeeper, as somebody who has to deny the information, not as somebody who wants to create transparency and accountability. So it's important that we remember that whenever we invoke the Right to Information Act, whether under Section 6 or under Section 4, that we remind the public information officers and the public authority that you have to provide this information in the interest of transparency and accountability. I think it's important to do that because this is a fact which is easily forgotten. The reason why the equation of the state to the citizen has become transformed, where the state treats us as subjects, is because we do not assert that this information is required to make their functioning transparent and accountable, nor do they regard themselves as being accountable. So this is something extremely important to recognize. So Shailesh ji has already pointed out what right to information is, and he has pointed out that it is inspection of work, documents, records, notes, samples. Interestingly, it's also information in electronic form. So a lot of this information can be asked under electronic form. So I'm going to skip this because this has already been dealt with by Shailesh. So as I pointed out, Section 6 requires information access as a privilege, because I have to go and say, please, sir, madam, can you give me this information? I am paying you 10 rupees, I am making this application, I am giving you 30 days, please give me information. In some ways, my need to invoke the Right to Information Act is a failure of governance. It's a failure of accountability. It's a failure of transparency. If I have to go and ask for something, it means that something is not working somewhere. So this also is an indication that Section 4 implementation has failed under this Act. Under the Right to Information Act, within 120 days of the passing of the Act, each public authority was required to suo moto make information available under Section 4 of the Act. So if this information is not available and I have to seek this information and I have to make an appeal if I do not get this information, then it is evident that there is a failure of accountability and transparency. So under Section 4.2 requires that as much information as possible should be made available suo moto. That means the public authority should make it possible for us to access information without needing to invoke Section 6. By itself. Under 4.3, this information has to be disseminated widely. So it is not that this information has to be kept in such a way that you have to go and seek it out from a needle in a haystack, or you have to, you know, look for it only in certain places. It has to be available widely, and in today's world, widely almost means that, you know, it has to be available on the internet, on the website. So if it's available on the website, then most people can access it, or it has to be available as a booklet which people can actually obtain if they do not have access to the net. This information has to be easily accessible. So this is what 4.2, 4.3 and 4.4 provide. So the information that I asked for from the Supreme Court should have been disseminated widely. It should have been easily accessible, and neither of which is the case. So if you look at Section 4.1a, It basically requires that every public authority keeps some kind of a catalogued information about what information they hold with themselves. So there has to be some catalogue which you should have access to, and you should be able to know that this public authority keeps this kind of information. 41B requires that within 120 days they publish a variety of information, which we will deal with in a moment. 41C and 41D are extremely important because this really covers the functioning of public authorities. So under 41C, it really covers all the policy decisions that are taken by every public authority. So when they take any, formulate any policies or take any important decisions which affect the public, then all facts pertaining to that have to be made available under section 41C. In practice, we find that almost no policy decisions are displayed under 41C on any website by almost any government agency. So I think it's important that 41C is something that is spread across the country and invoked by all of us repeatedly. If you want to become shenshas and begums, then I think if you don't ask what were the facts when you decided that you want to have a metro in Pune, what were the facts before you? What are the facts that you have when you actually decided on the new DP for Pune? What are the facts that you had when you created a policy on smart cities? If what were the facts when you actually formulated the new PPPs for doing various activities, which should have happened within a government agency which already existed under statutory law? Suddenly you have taken out certain functions that were statutory with a municipal body and or with some other government agency and privatized it. So what were the facts before you when you actually created the PPP? There is no information available today, and this information should have been available under 41C to all of us. If you look at 41D, they have to provide reasons for their quasi-judicial decisions or administrative decisions. So if these reasons are not accessible, that yes, you formulated these policies, what are the reasons that you had in order to create these? While it is true that under section 6 you may not ask for interrogation, I think 41D provides you for asking for reasons why you have taken certain policy decisions. And therefore it would be incorrect to say that I cannot ask you for why you have come up with this policy. I am entitled to know why you have decided to privatize garbage collection. I am entitled to know why you have decided to formulate a PPP arrangement for smart cities. I am entitled to know what are the reasons that the government has in selecting certain partners in this PPP arrangement. And this is the route that is available to me from the Right to Information Act. So it's important for you to recognize that 41C and 41D are perhaps the most powerful part of the Right to Information Act that can be invoked in order to make government accountable to every action that it is taking. So what else does it need to disclose? So under 41B, there are 5 main categories of information. There are 18 different parts which are given to 41B, but I like to group them into 5 categories to simplify the matter. So the first thing that they have to suo moto disclose is what is this government body all about, or government authority all about it? What is its organization and its function? So information regarding to the fact that what this organization is, what its role is, and what its function is. Second is, who are the people in this organization, who are employed by them? What are the powers given to them, under what act? And what is the compensation that they receive? So this is the second part which they have to suo moto declare. Then they have to also say, what is their mechanism for public participation in policy making? So this is something which they need to make available. Then they need to suo moto say, what are their financials, their budgets, and what are the projects that they are undertaking, and who are the beneficiaries of these projects. This is the fourth category. And the fifth category is, what is the provision that they have to provide you and me with access to information that is not covered by this and that is held by them. So if there is individual information about, let's say, your application for a passport or a driver's license that is not going to be on the website and you want to find out what happened to it, then what is your provision to access this information? So this is a disclosure which has to be made mandatory by every public authority under this act. And it had to make this disclosure 120 days after the act was passed. Sadly, even today, I think the compliance of this is very negligible. Very, very negligible. I'm not aware of a survey. Is there a survey which has happened nationwide to look at Section 4 implementation? Some kind, but not really a formal study, which probably needs to take place. And I think it's essential to hold public authorities responsible for, their compliance of Section 4.1, 4.1b, 4.1c, 4.1d. So if you look at 4.1b, the information about organization, its role and functions. So here are the different sections which constitute information about role and function that has to be suo moto be made available by this authority. First is particulars of organization and duties. Then the procedure followed in decision making and channels of accountability. Who is accountable for the decisions that they are taking? And how do we actually ensure that they are held accountable? What are the norms set for decision making? What are the rules, regulations and instructions and manuals, records that are used or under its control, which are used for decision making? This is all about information about the organization, role and function. If you look at the next section, which is about the people, the powers and the compensation, they are all required to have a directory of officers and employees. Most organizations don't even have a directory of who are their officers and employees, or they simply have a list of the senior officers. It's actually supposed to be a list of all the employees of the organization. I don't know how many of you find that when you go to several government offices, you cannot distinguish between who is a government officer and who is a middleman or an agent. Have you experienced this? So if you go to IGR, for example, Inspector General of Registration, their offices, you might discover that on the desk of the officer, there is often a middleman who is sitting, and there is no way for you to distinguish that this is a middleman who is actually taking your application and giving you a procedure which is not a procedure according to what is expected to be followed, because the procedure again has not been shared under 4.1b. So it's important that there is a list of all employees. It's important that there is a directory of all officers. And it's important, therefore, for you to also ask, can I see your ID or badge when you go to the office? You can only do that if you know that the name of that person is in the list of employees. Otherwise, there is no way for us to distinguish between somebody who is a government officer and who is not. Who's a government employee and who's not. There's no way to tell. And increasingly, there have been frauds where people have impersonated a government employee or a government officer and carried out tasks. So I think this is extremely important. What are the powers and the duties of the officers and employees? Many times when you go to these officers, they will tell you, I can do this for you, but it may not be in their power. And sometimes you are told that this cannot be done here, which is actually the job of that very employee. So the only way that you can know is that if this information was available publicly. Why should I have to invoke section 6 of the RTI and seek information whether what procedure I followed was correct or wrong? This procedure should have been there. This should have been told to me directly. So there should be no need for me to invoke section 6 at all. Then finally, what is the remuneration received by each of the officers is also expected to be put over here. Then what is the mechanism whereby any member of the public can participate in policy making? So if there is going to be a revision in terms of, let's say, formulating a new DP for or the new use of public gardens in any city, is there any way that the citizens can actually participate in the formulation of these policies? If suddenly the government is going to decide that we are going to scrap the use of driver's license or passport as a proof of address, is there any mechanism that you and I can participate in the formulation of this policy and say that this is wrong or this is right, or these are the issues which arise out of it? And if there is no mechanism for doing that, is that something which allows us to be Shahenshah and Begums? I suspect not. So it's important for us to be able to raise these questions. Of course, the normal thing is about asking about the financial projects and beneficiaries. So there, the first thing is, what is the budget allocated to each of these agencies? Most of the government authorities do not put up their budget in an accessible form, if at all, on the websites or in any publicly available literature which we can pick up from their office. So even if you look at most municipal bodies, you may not find an Excel spreadsheet of its budget statement in most cases. And some of them, when they are making it available, they are making it available as a PDF instead of making it available as an Excel file. So what happens is, you are preventing people from accessing information in the form it really should be made accessible. If I have an Excel file, I can actually analyze the financial numbers. If I have a PDF, I can look at it, but then, you know, it's 50 page budget document or 100 page budget document. I can't take all those numbers and put them back into an Excel spreadsheet to analyze it. It becomes a cumbersome step. So the logical thing would be to make an Excel spreadsheet available. So, but if you look at the budgets which are there at the union level, the state level of various departments, and at the local government level, they need to be made available under this section. Then what is the manner of execution of subsidy and benefit programs? Recently, I made an RTI with the Ministry of Finance, asking them for about who is responsible for keeping the database of who are the beneficiaries of all the benefits, subsidies and services delivered by the government of India, the state governments and the local governments. And this was under section 6. Interestingly, what do you expect the finance ministry to say?
We don't have such records.
This matter doesn't involve us. this information is does not concern the finance ministry. The whole basis of the Aadhaar Act, which was under the money bill, was to say that we will do targeted delivery of subsidies, benefits and services. So therefore, you said that with Aadhaar, you will be able to identify who is a beneficiary. So if you don't know who are the beneficiaries and who maintains the beneficiary data, then what is the use of your claiming that Aadhaar will help me to do that? Because this is a query after you pass the 2 years after you pass the Aadhaar bill, and you still don't know who are the beneficiaries. So therefore, who are you taking for a ride? Now, interestingly, they transferred my RTI to every state government in the country. And till today, and this was an RTI filed in February of 2018, till today, I keep receiving every day two or three replies from remote parts of India stating mostly that we don't have any list of beneficiaries and we don't know who prepares lists of beneficiaries. So this information, which should have been made available under section 41B 12 of who are the beneficiaries and the manner of delivering these subsidies and benefits, is not available with any government office, you know, at all, even today, even when I seek it under section 6. Then what are the particulars of recipients, concessions, permits, authorizations, etc.? Who have you given special authorization under PPP to actually carry out use some land? No information available. Your Reliance case, where if Metro Mumbai had been given certain land, what is the authorization granted to them? Should it not have been on some website which actually indicates that government has now authorized and granted some permit to a private body to use this? For every toll booth that we go through, should there not be information under 41B13 which actually says here is what has been authorized? No such information is available today because we are not implementing section 4 of the RTI the way it is required. Finally, about provisions for information access. So if you look at this, each authority is required to say how is the information held by it being made available, what are the categories of documents which it holds, and when can citizens actually go and visit this office and actually claim this information, what is the manner in which you can claim this information, who are the officers, the public information officers and appeal authorities who can help you access this information under RTI section 6. This is something that should be available. So, the question is, how do we make section 4 work? And I think this is something that a lot of people across India have been struggling with. And I think unless we launch a movement to make section 4 work, it's not going to work. Because section 4 is very inconvenient for transparency and accountability. And therefore, it is essential that all youngsters like you actually make sure that we are going to make section 4 work. So the first thing that we need to do is lobby with the information commissioners. I think the information commissioners must ensure minimum use of section 6. So I think it's important if we go to the information duties of the information commission. Whenever an order is passed by an information commission, I think it would be very useful if the information commissions were to examine what information that has been asked could have been made available under section 4 and why it was not available under section 4. So I think if this little initiative is taken to ensure that whenever a Section 6 order is passed, ensure that information would be made available, that same information or that category of information would be made available under Section 4 wherever possible. Second is that I think it's possible for information commissioners to themselves invoke Section 4 in order to ask public authorities to say what is the information available under Section 4. So I think holding each public authority which comes under that State Information Commission or the Central Information Commission accountable is extremely important. So currently, if the information commissions have become bodies, appellate bodies, I think they need to go beyond simply becoming appellate bodies into saying that how do I actually make sure that Section 4 is going to work? Because as we saw at the beginning, the purpose of this act is to enable accountability and transparency. And the purpose of this act is to ensure that people will have to, a purpose of Section 4 is to ensure that people will have to have minimum resort to the Right to Information Act. It is not in order to allow or enable us to invoke Right to Information Act. It is to minimize its use. So if the number of RTI applications are increasing, if the number of appeals is increasing, if the number of if the amount of pendency is increasing, I think it is an indication of the failure of Section 4. Therefore, I think there is a lot of attention that needs to be played on Section 4. In fact, I feel that a lot of litigation in the country will reduce if information, much of this information that I listed out was available under Section 4. So when we talk of Swaraj, you know, Swaraj is when I have this information, you know, I don't really need to go and assert myself. If I have to go and assert myself all the while and prove that I am the master and not the slave of the state, then there is no Swaraj. Today, if I have to plead with the public information officer, I have to appear before an appellate authority, and I have to make an appeal to the Central Information Commission, then I think obviously I am not the master. I am being treated as a subject. So it's also important that under Section 19(8)(a), a public authority should take all such steps as may be necessary to secure provisions under this Act from the public information officers, from the public authority. It's also important to use 25(5) of the Act in order to recommend to the public authority what steps they need to take to promote conformity to Section 4. So this is something which is extremely important for the information commissioners to undertake. So while I think it's one thing to say that the Central Information Commissioners and the State Information Commissioners have a major role to ensure Section 4 is implemented, I think you and I can also do a lot of things to make sure that Section 4 is implemented. So here is a couple of suggestions to all of you. So I think all of you should actually, I think Shailesh Gandhi suggested that you file at least one RTI every month, right? I would say that you file an RTI which is going to be focusing its attention on three things. First is with the CICs and SICs. I think let us ensure that these bodies work. I think Shailesh Gandhi has pointed out that it is absolute jugaad that you would get an information commissioner like him to be there and ensure that people's rights are upheld. So I'll give you an instance. In my own case, I have 6 pending appeals before the Central Information Commissioner, which have been admitted since March 2018, and there's been no hearing. You know, there has been no hearing. So I asked Mr. Sridhar Acharyalu, who just retired as the Central Information Commissioner. Of course, it was not before him. So to get somebody like him and Shailesh Gandhi is, absolute good fortune. But most of the times, the person before whom it is pending has just kept it pending. I have no recourse. I can do nothing. I had almost all of my appeals before the State Information Commissioner in Pune over the last 10 years has been disposed of without a hearing. So I have no recourse. I have absolutely no recourse, and this is after waiting for 3 years. So I feel that we have to hold these bodies accountable. So let us start by saying that we will ask the CIC questions. We will ask the SIC questions. Let's hold them accountable first. So what information can we ask? First, let's see if they are Section 4 compliant. Can we actually, make an application saying that under Section 6, saying please provide all information that you have made available under Section 4 of this Act. In fact, if you were to do a project as a part of your regular curriculum and you were to do this with every SIC across the country, you can compile a comparative study of which of the SICs in the country are Section 4 compliant. I think it would be a very important step. So just a year and a half ago, Anjali Bharadwaj did a very interesting study of the pendency across different states and the way in which SICs were functioning in order to rank their performance, and also to look at how many vacancies existed in various state information commissions. So I think just like that, it's important to do a study of Section 4 compliance of SICs and CICs across the country. Second is, what are the orders which they have issued, or number of orders they have issued where they have asked for Section 4 to be complied with? Is there a single order that they have passed in the year where they have asked a public authority to comply with Section 4? If they have not asked for it, then obviously they will at least hopefully 1 out of 10 SICs or CICs will scratch their head and say, maybe this is a possibility for me to do in my next order. So I think it's important to ask this question. Then I think it's also important to ensure that we ask them to comply with 41C and 41D, which means whatever policy decisions which affect the public that they have taken should be made public under Section 41. So ask about what are these decisions that they have taken which affect the public, and which of these are up on the website, and what are the reasons for these. So by holding the SIC and CIC accountable to this, I think we will make a step further whereby they will hold others accountable to 41C, 41D and other Section 4. Second is, I think the courts, since you are all aspiring lawyers, I think it's equally important to ask for information about public interest cases which are pending before High Courts and Supreme Court. And I think that transparency and accountability has to happen. I think increasingly there are a lot of people who are filing PILs which are not in public interest, and therefore genuine public interest litigations are being disposed or dismissed with costs when you know, they actually need to be heard. So in order to be able to distinguish between frivolous and genuine cases, if there is a transparency and accountability created in terms of what public interest litigations go before the courts, there will be some sense of justice which will come in. So I think it's important to ask the courts to ensure that all public interest matters are available under 41C for public display. So we know what are the prayers before the court, what are the decisions taken on those prayers. We also know what are the reasons. So I think somebody like me should not be made to invoke an RTI application and go to the Supreme Court or the High Court asking for these questions. It's also important to ask questions of each ministry or each public authority in the government. So what question should we be asking before each ministry? So the first is about policy decisions which have been taken by them in the current year. A list of these policy decisions should be up on the website under 41C. They should be giving the facts which were before them up on the website. So I think every ministry, at the central and state level, and also every department of the local body should be asked to display information under 41C and 41D of important decisions which are affecting the public. Today this information is not there on the websites. So I think if each one of you were to actually select one local government, one state government department and one central government department and ask them questions under 41C and 41D, I think we will certainly make our policy makers sit up before they take decisions which are going to adversely affect the public. There is no way in which this is going to change if we keep fighting an individual battle. Unless, see, the power of Section 4 of RTI is that it suddenly doesn't become an individual battle. It's about holding the government accountable and ensuring transparency. It's no longer about an Anupam Saraph or a Shailesh Gandhi or a Vinita Deshmukh making an RTI application and pursuing a matter which they are familiar with or in which they feel some public interest has been hindered. It's a question of simply saying that all of us who are actually the rulers of this country and we have appointed government servants in order to carry out the tasks for us, tell us about these important things on which they have to be accountable to us. So, if Right to Information Act has to become a right and not remain a privilege, I think it is going to be important for us to invoke Section 4. So, my plea to you that over the next year, each one of you should log at least 12 applications under section in asking information under Section 4. Thank you very much.